Greetings, Africa. Greetings, African sisters and brothers. This is EBUKHOSINI Solutions, introducing our programs and also launching our website. We are very happy. Tokozo Mashiana has worked extremely hard to make sure that we can have a beautiful website. And we also thought we should take the opportunity to introduce more about what we do and who we are, because a number of people have heard about EBUKHOSINI Solutions. Some may have visited us or been part of our program. But how do we operate? Who are we? What do we do? And how do we go about the business that we are engaged in? So I am Baba Buntu. I founded EBUKHOSINI in 2002. I'm here together with some very beautiful colleagues. And Mama, you can introduce yourself.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Tebogo Buntu. I'm the director of EBUKHOSINI Solutions.
Greetings, everyone. My name is Khanyisa, and I am a board member of EBUKHOSINI.
Yes. So here we are giving you a little bit of an insight to who and what we are as EBUKHOSINI Solutions. We started this company in 2002, and we focus specifically on African-centered education. So we want to take people on learning journeys. We think that Africa has an incredible history, incredible knowledge, incredible science, and we think that the whole world should know about it. But first and foremost, our communities need to know our history, and that's what we want to contribute to. We are inspired by Africa. We are inspired by the knowledge. We are inspired by the history, the great heroes and heroes that this continent has produced, but too often are marginalized, forgotten, and not put at the center. That's what we want to contribute to. I'm going to ask Mama Tebogo Buntu to say something about a tagline. We have a tagline called Ancient Traditions, Modern Solutions. What does that mean?
Thank you so much, Baba. Our tagline, as Baba has said, Ancient Tradition, Modern Solution. We are looking at getting inspiration from Asian African knowledge, and we're asking ourselves, that's the tagline that we are using, but at the same time, it's like a question. How do we take Asian way of understanding and knowing, and how do we use it right now where we find ourselves to bring us solutions? So that is why our tagline is Asian Tradition, Modern Solution. We know that every time, whatever that we do, we don't just find ourselves being the first one that we are doing something. There's always been a foundation of where particular knowledges are coming from. And this time we are talking about African knowledge, its foundation. How do we draw and understand from it and bring it to where we are right now to solve our problems that we are facing? Thank you.
And EBUKHOSINI is a business, it's a community space, and it's a home. And these are three aspects that we want to unpack together with the beautiful panel of the EBUKHOSINI family, who you will be introduced to as we go. But before we go any further, I want to ask Khanyisa Mhlongo, who has worked with EBUKHOSINI for a very long time, to say something about EBUKHOSINI and EBUKHOSINI being a learning space. What does that mean?
So I am going to just share it from my experience when I came in. We were one of the first people to start the Nubian Book Club. So it's like there's a library, you can't see it now, but there's a huge library that has a lot of books that are written by Black people, African people, where you can learn from them. And it's very fun because we have Mama T, who has a very wide understanding, and she knows how to related to our lives right now, like it's modern solutions. I mean, modern solution with ancient traditions. Yes. So that's one. And then what else, Baba?
So I think also that we want to engage people in conversation, dialogues, learning. There's different ways of learning, storytelling, poetry, arts. There's different ways. And we want to inspire the great talents that we know we have in our community.
Yes, exactly that. So there's confident parents. There's African dialogues on Sundays. There are conversations that we have. We have workshops with everyone in the group. We've met, we've discussed. We have Black love and everything. So I think that's how it becomes like a learning space. It's a home as well, but it's also like a company. So it's interesting.
Yes. Thank you so much, Khanyisa. We also have a board, as was mentioned, and on the board we have Yonela Boya, who's also going to be with us just now. Khanyisa Mhlongo is on that board. Pitsira Rahopala is another director who's also on the board. And together we work with a whole host of family members who serve as volunteers, as program coordinators. We also want to now outline a few of the things that we do. So we've spoken about a little bit about who we are as EBUKHOSINI. Now we want to talk about our educational services. We want to talk about our consulting services. We want to talk about what kind of interventions we do in communities. And we want to talk about EBUKHOSINI as a home. What does that mean? So be open to learn and to engage with us as we continue into this journey. I want us to go into the segment of educational services. I'm going to ask my co-director, Mama T, to take us through that segment.
Okay, thank you so much again, Baba. On this segment, we are going to look at some of the work that we do. We do lectures, we do training programs, we do leadership development. However, this is the work that we're using to reach out to different communities that we are working with. I will now go into some of the people that are more active into the work that we are doing. I will start with Mbali Kgame, who's going to share his experience. He's one of the coordinators and volunteers for KWANZAA. So Mbali Kgame, can you just share your experience as being one of the long, long, long volunteers?
Yes.
I know every day you always think of resigning, but you come back after having a very beautiful time. So can you just share why do you think KWANZAA is important as one of the events that you have to put out in the community?
Yes. Thank you, Mama T, for that question. Greetings, family. My name is Mbali Kgame, and yes, I am one of the long-standing volunteers,
Absolutely.
I've been a part of the KWANZAA Planning Committee since 2014. I did have, I think, one break in between where I did not participate. However, been part of the KWANZAA Planning Committee where we host or we plan the African Harvest Festival that is hosted and observed by EBUKHOSINI Solutions every year on the 26th of December, where we have the opening ceremony observing the principle of Umoja. Being part of the committee has been such an interesting learning experience. As a commercial or mainstream it holds its group of researchers, they started to research different African fast food festivals or observing African fast food ceremonies, and they found that in Africa we have a common way of observing, and they conceptualized KWANZAA. However, with EBUKHOSINI, it's a one-day event where we observe and affirm being African. Yes, African family, apologies, network problems. But as I was saying, that bringing KWANZAA to the community or having been part of hosting KWANZAA in South Africa has brought about African consciousness and spoke to that the Ntate Mabule's call on always affirming Africa, because African people come from different backgrounds, different religious backgrounds, different beliefs, and they come together in observing and celebrating Africa, but not just in a way that centers around celebration, but in also a way that is reflective and is about bringing together ideas that will foster and will inspire tangible transformation within our community. So KWANZAA is a decolonial practice because it has the idea of community at the center point, and EBUKHOSINI has made it a primary objective to always collaborate with other community organizations who are already on ground working and doing the everyday work of always affirming Africa and bringing about African consciousness to the people. So these different organizations then partner with EBUKHOSINI, bringing in their services, bringing in their skills, and making sure that KWANZAA is a great success every year. And KWANZAA speaks to the idea of drawing away from colonial traditions or colonial ways of being, colonial ways of measuring who is human and who is not human, in order for us to remember that history happened and so much was imposed to us and taken away from us. And KWANZAA becomes that platform where, as African people, we are able to reflect and we're able to remember who we are and what we stood for before colonial impositions and colonial ways of detecting who's human and who's not human. I also want to mention that being inspired by Dr. Karenga and his team has also brought about a reflection for us on ground within the African continent to study and know about the African harvest festivals that have been in practice in ancient times and have also been lost in the now. So that also brings in a learning experience for us to know about the ways in which we observed the harvest festivals and the different practices that we can adopt within our homes, within our community, nationally, in our continent, and also incorporating and including the larger African family from here at home and abroad.
Yes, thank you so much, everybody. Omphemetse. Oh, I was just saying that you can share with us when it comes to the business world, the work that you do, because you are one of the people that has been working with EBUKHOSINI when it comes to that part of the business world and EBUKHOSINI, just to share your experience. And why do you think that is important from the services that you are providing?
Okay. Well, I've been a son of EBUKHOSINI for many, many years. And within those many years, I've worked in many different corporations. In the corporate world. And in my experience, as a Black man, as a Black person in the corporate world, which has a very Western culture, I have seen that there is a big need, and it has been growing every single year, that there is a big need for trying to cement an African culture in our corporate environments. Unfortunately, in South Africa, when we get into the corporations that are run by the big companies, the culture is still very, very Western. You'd think that you are in an office in England or the USA. But in the past few years, I think HR and the different leaders within the corporations and the people at large, they've seen that there is a need to bring up an authentic African culture. And from my dealings with EBUKHOSINI, I've seen that they are the people that are able to bring such a culture in an authentic way, because as well, we want the culture to be authentic and not to be a watered down Western / African culture. So there is a big need within corporate, that the people on the ground, they are crying for something that is more African. And I think we have been patient long enough, and right now we really want to make sure that the next generation of people that will be working in corporate, they will be working in a culture that is not 100% Western as we have been, and it is more African.
Thank you so much, Omphemetse, for that overview, and even to add a little bit of, and even also to add a little bit of the challenges that most of the people are finding in the workplace of expressing themselves of who they are. And we know that those interventions are important to bring in. We will then go to our next segment, which is the relevancy of EBUKHOSINI right now. We will take a video from the elder Ntate Mkhine Mabule to give us that overview, why, from his perspective, why that why it is relevant to have an organization that will be able to bring a more understanding of our knowledge. So we will then go into the video of Ntate Mkhine.
Greetings, fellow Africans. For me, EBUKHOSINI Solutions remains relevant for three reasons. One, it invokes an introspection of ancient and contemporary African traditions for current and future generations to fashion dynamic solutions to ongoing situations that Africans find themselves in. I've often remarked that our ancients responded to circumstances they found themselves in innovative ways. So to speak, they created culture. They were culturally proactive than just merely reactive. They understood that culture is dynamic and central to their resilience, not only in response to racism and dispossession, but also in relation to their identity and survival. Thus, EB remains relevant because it centers its programs and activities on resilience and prospect of the African family as a unit of society and African people in general. To date, I'm yet to hear of a national or intercontinental program aimed at sustaining this unit of society, especially in the face of disintegration of family, economic challenges, and moral dilemmas Africans are faced with. Finally, EB programs are interactive, broad, and dynamic in their coverage of circumstances and issues that have been influencing African-centered values and identity. They cut across historical and contemporary influences, thus offering multiple solutions for individuals and families to draw inspiration they can act on.
Thank you, Ntate Mabule, and thank you for making even time to make this video on behalf of EBUKHOSINI, even though we know that you are not in a good health, but you always been there and making some time. I will then go to the next segment, which is Modern Solutions and the Professional Opportunities.
So Modern Solutions and Ancient Traditions, what are some of the ways that businesses can collaborate with EBUKHOSINI Solutions? I think that firstly, we have a very great experience and connections with the youth, right? Like I'm the youth, I'm from Yovo, you know, so I know what's happening in the streets. I know what's happening in my community. I know what we are going through, right? And I know how to reach out to my fellow friends, sisters, brothers, like just everyone on the street who will be able to share their own experience being a person in the city. And then also with EBUKHOSINI Solutions, because we are such a huge family, right? It's not only me who's in Yeovil in the city, but we also have people that we know that are ekhaya, like in KZN, we have a relation with the Institute of Africology, who are also doing some amazing work in researching African perspectives, African knowledge, indigenous knowledge that they are practicing. And so that's the practicality of what EBUKHOSINI Solutions is. We have a practical practice of indigenous knowledge systems. And so that's one way that professionals can engage with us, because abo baba bafundile. So when mama funde kanjalo, they teach us the youth, because not all of us go through that line of university, but they teach us how to research, because when I first started researching, I did that with the South African Network Cities, and it was an experience. I was a co-researcher. I was busy. I was very busy. And then also within the community, within the community, there are people that are very much talented, such as Brother Ntokozo, who can help you with the website, right? So there can be ways for us to collaborate. Other ways for us is also when you invite us to come and speak, then we present whatever it is that we are presenting with the research that we have done. And that's also a way of you engaging with us. And then the other part that was also very exciting, EBUKHOSINI Solutions for me in my younger years coming up has given me so much opportunity that I'm even able to speak like this, that one time we went to Hatfield and it was a beautiful experience, and we were something, assistant lecturers.
Yeah, assistant lecturers and facilitators.
And facilitators. And it was an experience. It was amazing. We were sitting there and very nervous, but we were very happy to have that opportunity. So that's something that we can also come in and do. We can facilitate workshops. We can facilitate events. We can also help you have an event, because we have a lot of knowledge about African practices. Mama T will come, like, I remember the last time we had an event, and I was like, no, Mama T, I need you to come and help us set up, because this setup is not right. It's giving corporate, it's giving everything. And then she came, you know, and she assisted us to have that setup that was very nice, that allows communication, that allows everyone to be free, you know, so that we are all together and we can all communicate. Thanks.
Thank you, Mbali. We will then go into the... Did I call you Mbali?
I'm telling you that.
It's all family. So.
We will then go to video of one of our board of directors, Peter Rath, how that preparation from just being here and learn about the things that he had learned, and then how he make use of them where he finds himself right now in the USA. So we will go into Peter Ra's video.
Power, peace, and blessings, African children all over the world. My name is Pitira Raopala. I am a proud son of this royal house, EBUKHOSINI. KOBUKHOSINI. Since 2009, I have been part of this extraordinary programs that we do, that I have seen so many people changing their lives. I've seen so many people growing. I've seen so many people getting married right in front of me. I've seen so many people building homes and businesses. I've seen so many people walking tall with confidence. And that tells me that this work is important. Living in Brooklyn, New York right now, I meet some of the people from Azania who know about our work. And you may think people don't know, but people know. And us who are the representative of these teachings, when we talk, when we walk, people listen and people admire. So I say we have to continue doing this work, for Africa needs it. For the African people need this royal house. We have to continue the work as the custodians of our ancestral knowledge. Find us on social medias as EBUKHOSINI Solutions, and let's walk this journey together. And united, we shall win.
Thank you so much, Yamabala. Thank you. We'll then go to the next segment, which is it's about EBUKHOSINI and the academic world. And this one is going to be shared by our advocate,
yes,
Sipho Mantula.
Sipho Mantula!
This is one of the first sons of EBUKHOSINI. Yeah, we found you here. So it's good to see you. It's good to see you, Ntate Mantula. We know that you have very hectic schedule, but to make time just to be here and share your experience and especially in the experience that you have right now being in the academic world. So, Ntate Mantula,
Jalo Mohamme, Nkosi Sabonga, Jambo Africa, Madume Africa, proud and humbled to see sons and daughters of Ebukhosini, to see our elders, to see our founders, our directors, very humbled that being the son of Ebukhosini, we are the son of the fertile soil. I think we at Ebukhosini, we have been on this journey for many years. I cannot count the years, but looking at the intellectual space, academic world, Ebukhosini has penetrated academic spaces, has penetrated government conferences on the role of an African child, on the space of an African child. And you'll recall that when we talk of Pan-African way of life, Ebukhosini will bring all communities of practice from the Rastafari community, from the Hebrew Israelite, from our healers, indigenous healers, from our scholars from near and far. Ebukhosini on Pan-African spaces and the Pan-African philosophy. During this month also, it is also interesting of the Black History Month or the Africa History Month. It has been one of the founding pillars of Ebukhosini when we talk of the Africa Month, commemorating it, celebrating it with communities, uptown, downtown. We've been everywhere in the ghetto. And then also when we do Africa Liberation Month, what people used to call it Africa Day, Ebukhosini was not fashionable. It sticked on Africa Liberation Day. That's how we used to push on Africa Liberation Day. Come Marcus Garvey Month, you know, Ebukhosini stood for Marcus Garvey Day. And the wives of Garvey, the empresses, we never looked at Garvey as a single Black hero, as a Black fighter, but we look Garvey and the wives of Garvey. And I think one of our daughters of the soil covered KWANZAA. I will not go on KWANZAA. So when you look at the intellectual space, I think Ebukhosini has made inroads and it will still make some inroads. I think from basic education to higher education, Ebukhosini solution, it is still relevant and it will still be relevant even after us and even those who are coming after us and those who have been before us. Abo Ntate Khalushi Koka, Abo Sister Ya Ashantewa. There are many that I can count, you know, from near and far, from diaspora, living spora. So I think that's where Mama T, for some of us, the Pan-African spirit, it was grounded by Abo Baba Buntu, alongside Libo Baba Begi. I don't know how many of you remember Brother Begi from Marcus Garvey movement, from Alexandra. You know, and many people used to sleep at Ebukhosini who were great, you know, scholars, writers. That was in Fitas, by the way. Before Ebukhosini moves to the farm, I think viewers must know that Ebukhosini started in an old township of Gauteng called Fitas, you know, Frederdorp. So that's where we should understand that's the grounding, where we say it was grounding with our brothers and our sisters.
You see, this is the person who knows where Ebukhosini started. Like, this is an ancient ancestor of you know, all those who enrolled in different spaces and pushing, go to the media, even today. And we still give thanks for those opportunities that even today, you know, there are spaces that is not easy to enter with this kind of knowledge, but to have the foot soldiers that know and they never go back to make sure that we enter everywhere, even if we are not wanted, we will come and make sure that we make our presence to be seen. And right now it's even beautiful because a lot of spaces are now opening. And I think because we are becoming gray now, we will also rest a little bit. But thank you so much, Advocate Mantula, for that overview and for sharing.
Thank you so much, Mama. So one thing that is very important for us in Ebukhosini is to also share the methodology of how to rise as a leader. I think there are aspects within our communities where we also have gotten used to unhealthy forms of leadership, leaders who are full of self, leaders who want to be very powerful and dominate. We want to adhere more to a leadership that is to serve the community. And because we don't always see so many examples of what that leadership looked like, we need to then demonstrate it and involve it into training journeys, internships, exchange programs. We have done internships for many, many years, and there are also people in the meeting today that will speak a little bit about that experience. And we want to allow especially young people to walk a journey where they are guided, where they are mentored, where they get advice, where they are being affirmed as great potential leaders in this world. Africa needs leadership, but more than anything, we need people who serve this continent. Epistemic justice is something that often comes up as a keyword because we know that one of the injustices, one of the many injustices that Africa has suffered for a long time is that our knowledge is not at the center. It's marginalized, it's put out in the cold, and it's not seen as very tangible to the extent that we ourselves also don't think of African knowledge as extremely important and a very high level. And as a Bukhosini, we want to bring that back and we want to share that with those who are interested in walking that journey. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. We, as a Bukhosini, we are interested on also working with elders. It is important to integrate elders in our work that we are doing. The reason being that our elders need, they are in a different space of where we are, whereby they need also a particular voice that understand the world the way it is right now, so that we can be the one that assist and work with them to validate the knowledge that they have. Because the knowledge that they have is the knowledge that right now we realize how much we need. And when we don't work with them, we'll end up bring us things from our head and thinking that we are the first ones to come up with certain understanding, whilst there are people who have been sitting there with that knowledge. And we know that the understanding of our indigenous knowledge, as they say, it's a tacit knowledge. It is in their mind. It is in their understanding. Our responsibility is how do we make it practical? How do we make it tangible? And us as young people, as people that are advocating for the understanding of our knowledge, it is us that we need to be able to work with them through the networks that we have, through the research, so that we validate and give dignity to the knowledge that we are having. So working with elders is an important part of the work that we're supposed to be doing all the time. We give thanks for that.
Thank you so much, Mama, for covering our educational programs. We now want to go into a segment of our consulting services. And I think Khanyisa gave a very beautiful profile of some of the things that we do with businesses, within organizational spaces. There are many people who hire us and contract us to do work for and with them. So we are in the conference space, we are in the space of developing curriculums. We spoke about mentorship. And I think very central to the approach that we take is anti-oppressive methodology. And it's something that we need to learn because we realize that even as we enter universities and business spaces, some of the things we learn from textbooks are by nature oppressive or exploitative. So we need to unlearn that and find African wisdom to really do it the way we're supposed to. So it involves research and writing. At this point, I'm very excited to invite to the stage somebody who has been part of this journey for a very long time again. Ntate Mabule, as somebody who has been with us for a very long time, he came on board when EBUKHOSINI was quite different than what it is now. And Ntate, I want you to give a little bit of texture to what was it like to join EBUKHOSINI almost 20 years ago. And what is the difference between the experience of being part of that at that time? And we know that society has developed a bit since that time. What have you seen over those 2 decades? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Baba, and greetings to everyone. I must put a disclaimer that if I don't look as handsome as I normally do, it's because of low shady. So I still am a very handsome young man. Let's start with that. But I'm very happy. I'm very happy. But I must say I'm also very jealous of Chimobi because it looks like all of us are getting old. Chimobi is getting very young. This thing must, he must tell us there must be some integration of knowledge there. But my greetings, advocates, good to see you, your Nella as well, and all other sons and daughters of EBUKHOSINI, whom I know and met, and those that I haven't met. When Baba gave me this opportunity, I think it was a responsibility because we haven't been able to engage on a personal basis for a very long time because I was also engaged in this project of family that I'm in, which I think in itself, the basis of it, it's all that I've learned from EBUKHOSINI, that I've took this course to say, I should get this part right. But Baba is correct. For me, EBUKHOSINI has to be juxtaposed with also just our democracy as a society in South Africa. Because at the period where EBUKHOSINI was emerging and many of us were young, there were very few spaces where you could get a full articulation of what it means to be an African, and practically so. In fact, when we started, the only prescription that existed was us reading a stack of books. So it came to a point where we have read all out. You know, we know. And we could engage, we could argue, but then it became a little bit frustrating to our spirits because people became content with knowing and regurgitating, but then their actions were not incongruent with what it is that is deeply us and African about ourselves. So it became a very frustrating process, but it was part of our building process. And EBUKHOSINI at the center was the only institution that gave a practical expression of that. If there was very few, but also if there was, those few were also aligned to EBUKHOSINI, because I could only think of people like Mamaya, sometimes Ntate Mabule Mokhine, all of them were somehow linked in one way or the other through the work of EBUKHOSINI. So at that time, EBUKHOSINI became very significant to many of us because we needed to understand practically what it is, how it is that we are Africans, what is our daily ritual, how do we behave, how do we think, how do we engage, how do we support each other, all of these things practically, not in a philosophical sense, not in a sense of mass mobilization and you know, all of these things. It was really practical that from the moment you wake up, this is how you must cultivate your spirit as a young person to be able to center yourself to face the world. Because at the time, everything else around us was highly Europeanized. And that we know that was a standard of progress in many ways. And the practicality of being an African was not yet attractive. But EBUKHOSINI made it attractive. And as a young person, that became a very fulfilling thing to see. In fact, many of us still continue with those practices to ground ourselves in our homes and our communities. And so as a result of how we act and carry ourselves, there was a lot of people that we touched. So I know that there are a lot of people that did not necessarily come to EBUKHOSINI, but we're touched by the work that we do and how we carry ourselves, the same way that it was expressed by Rahopala there. So at that time, that was largely the context. But then now, over time, because of the services that EBUKHOSINI offers, the consultation, I remember we did workshops around the xenophobic attacks. I mean, EBUKHOSINI was at the center. And even one institution that put on the center the concept of Afrophobia, to say that, and I remember it was about 2008, and we were saying, but this thing of killing foreigners, it's not happening to the other race of people, it's happening to ourselves. So what does it mean when we do that to ourselves? So EBUKHOSINI was at the forefront of answering that particular question. And it was an eye-opening to a lot of people, to say, but we need to understand this much more deeper, because many of the people carried within their consciousness the idea that because they are foreigners, there's no other connection and relation to ourselves. So we are othering them and we are othering them, but we not being aware that we are doing it in a way that we are not doing it to any other race but ourselves. So after that, then it propelled many of the behaviors, conducts, and the manner in which we carried ourselves was reflected through that period. And like I'm saying, Ebukhosini gave us the practicality of being African and how to be African on a daily basis. Now today you have a lot of people that knows, that behaves and affirms themselves as being African. So it answered that particular transition that many of us were frustrated by for so long. So now it's a space where that I think it's affirmative and just needs to expand in that direction. That's all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Retumetse Ropulane, for what you have shared. It's really, really beautiful to hear those reflections. And for those of you who are joining us and watching this segment, we are not trying to say that we are the only ones who do this work or that everything that we do is so easy and so great. We are just sharing with you why we think it's important and what we have learned from these journeys. I want to call in another son of the house, Tabelo Metangari, to share a little bit about one program that we have, which is called Black Education Masterclass. Please share with us, Tabelo.
Oh, greetings, listen family, greetings. Greetings, my Africa Mahe. And thank you for this opportunity. Thank you, Buntu. Thank you to everyone that is in this space now. I think I won't really say a lot because people that are already that have already spoken before me, they've really unpacked Ebukhosini nicely. But I'm just here to speak about one program that I'm also so much involved into. I don't know whether I became a part of that because of my background in the teaching space or what, but I'm part of the Black Education Masterclass, which is one of the programs that Ebukhosini also facilitates. The main idea behind that is just to introduce people to the Black consciousness. Those that are really interested, that they want to awaken their spirits and the love of understanding who we are as the Black African people. So that is basically the platform, which is virtual. It happens virtually. And then it seeks to emancipate Black women, men, and all the youth, right? And it's also rooted in the Pan-African philosophy and Black consciousness practice, which was conceptualized in 2020, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, I'm very much correct. In 2020, that's when the whole Black Education Masterclass was conceptualized. So we come together from different corners of the world to just engage and empower ourselves and also raise awareness of who we are as the people of Africa and what does it really mean to be an African and what can we do to make sure that, at least in the education space, we are getting the right knowledge that we need as the Black African people so that we can be empowered in the right manner. So thank you so much. I don't know if I still need to expand, but I feel like I've said enough about the Black Education Masterclass. I'm involved in the space as a coordinator, where my role is basically to connect the speakers and the moderators to the audience. So we have speakers from different corners of the world, and they are knowledgeable around the topics that they come to share with us in the space. So basically, that's just about it. Thank you
so much, Tabelo. It's beautiful what you have outlined, and a very important program, which we started mainly during the experience of COVID lockdown, and it has really picked up. Season 5 is going to come this year, so make sure you take part in that. What you are really experiencing here is a family gathering, and that's the experience of Ebukhosini. I want to quote something that Khanyisa said, and it may sound a little bit silly, but there's something profound in it. She said, you know, the experience of Ebukhosini is that you come and you are so down from what you go on, what you do in your own life, and then you come to an Ebukhosini event, and then you meet other sons and daughters of Ebukhosini. And then you say, and then people ask, so how are you? No, I'm fine. You know, I crossed the road. You crossed the road? Wow, she crossed the road. And what it meant was like, even as a thing that maybe others don't see as an achievement, at EBUKHOSINI, you would get that feedback and that affirmation. And I think when she said that, we laughed really hard about it, but it was also very profound, because what it meant is that even the small things are noticed and picked up, and you get some oomph, because we need some oomph and power in this life. And oomph and power, as Ritumetse was saying, we have somebody who looks younger than his age, so I'm not going to disclose it, but Chimobi Ahamba is one of the members who does not stay within the country of Azania or South Africa. He's actually based in Norway, and he's helping us a lot on this meeting with the technical aspects, but he's also part of one of our programs. And I wanted him to share very briefly, what are some of the, what program are you part of, and what are some of the needs of our young men and women?
Chimo. Give thanks, Baba. Well, first and foremost, Black Power greetings to my African family across the globe. Chimobi Ahamba is the name. I'm based in the cold northern chapter of Babylon called Norway. But I am blessed to be a part of the EBUKHOSINI family. I'm in the core team, the HCT, as we call it. And primarily these days, I am a facilitator for Teen Talks, which is, I think we call it a guided reflection session. That's what we call Teen Talks. So essentially, what we do is we gather young people together, and then we discuss any current, any relevant topics that are ongoing or that we think are relevant for young people. So essentially, we do this online because obviously I'm in Norway. One of the other facilitators is based in the US. Then two of them are based in South Africa. So definitely we have to do this online to get as many as we can on board and in the session. And we have youngsters between, and we're speaking primarily with young men, just so that's said. We're speaking to young men between the ages 12 and all the way up to 18. So we have level one and level two, and we separate them by age. So I'm currently a level two facilitator, but until recently, I was there for level one.
Thank you so much, Chimobi Ahamba. That was short and sweet, and a motivation there why we need to also cater to our young. And I want to say this to us as Pan-African organizations, sometimes we neglect the youth. Sometimes we are not so youth friendly. We like to think of young people to be our members and be in our midst, but are we really doing the work that young people find interesting and important? So let's really work on that. I want us to play a video by another member of the EBUKHOSINI family, Tsepo Tobejane, who has been with us on several committees and also worked quite extensively in those who want to donate and support. So let's listen to what Tsepo says about how you can support the work of EBUKHOSINI.
Madume Ma Afrika, Kalina Kitsepo Watobejane. I've been with EBUKHOSINI Solutions since 2018, which was the year where I participated in a Shabaka event called Men on the Mountain. I moved on to join and participate in many of their other programs and events. And what I found very remarkable is how these high value events would be, if not at a low cost, would be at no cost at all. What comes top of mind is the KWANZAA opening ceremony, which is based on the African First Fruits Harvest celebration. So for this event, we would have costs from venue hire, logistics, all the way to catering for the kids' play school. And this is offered without any payment at all and without any official donor. And hence, there's a big reliance in having, you know, fundraising through the African family. So I want to use this opportunity to encourage you to contribute and donate. There are various platforms of how you can, you know, contribute. You could donate through the PayPal, you can donate directly through bank transfer, or whenever we launch a crowdfunding, just you could also donate there. But most importantly, EBUKHOSINI Solutions offers professional services. If you can then contract or use our, you know, the services, be speaking engagements, training programs, or even counseling services. If the other ways of other contributing is on social media, you know, forward, like our posts, and just engage, and we give thanks.
Thank you so much to Tsepo Tobejane. One of the things he mentioned was our counseling services, and I just wanted to quickly also share that we open up spaces for healing, counseling, mentoring, Mama Tebogo runs a number of sessions with people who sign up to be part of that. I also do the same, and we also work with other healers and people who walk journeys of restoration, holistic health. And this is very important. We realize that as African people, we have a lot of generational trauma, we have racial trauma, we have scars that has been inflicted on us over a long time and through generations. And it's important to do something to undo those imbalances. Now we are coming to the segment about our community interventions. And I want to give to Mama to take us into that.
Thank you so much, Baba. When it comes to the community engagement, community participation, really with this one, it's just to make sure that we collaborate with different organizations. We create those partnerships. Because those are our partners. We know that to do this work is not easy, and to even make sure that it comes out there that people can understand. And it's important that we collaborate. We collaborate with all community organizations that are working on these issues of African knowledge. We collaborate with the universities, we collaborate with the government, we collaborate with NGO, we collaborate with everyone who's out there. It is important that we collaborate, because when we are working also as individuals, it becomes very difficult to make sure that we spread the same knowledge that we have to everyone. So for us, the community is those people of like-mindedness, those people who are also doing the work within their community to develop and to give capacity to them. Thank you.
We are then going to listen to one of the daughters of Ebukhosini. Her name is Matsepo Sesiane, and she is going to talk about the importance of books, literature. Let's hear from you, Matsepo.
Greetings, Baba. Greetings, African family. It's such an honor to be joining you tonight. My name is Matsepo Sesiane. I've been with Ebukhosini from about 2013. I'm one of the co-founders of the Nubian Children's Book Club, alongside Khanyisa Mhlongo. She was one of my coordinators as well. And then we did African Play School, which is a segment of the yearly KWANZAA ceremony that we have. And the importance of reading African books for me stems from two things mainly. Self-knowledge, knowledge of self, knowledge of culture, knowledge of the African continent. And knowledge of that. And then what should we do if books are boring and we don't want to read? Reading can never be boring, honestly. It can never be boring. Reading actually empowers you to serve your community in a better way. It expands your knowledge on who you are as an African youth, as an African elder. It empowers you to go and serve your community, teaching them about where they come from, who they are within the African continent. And it's been an honor to actually serve the Bukhosis of this life. Being able to teach them, I think it's the biggest honor, because you see knowledge differently from their eyes and how they take in about who they are as young kings and princes and princesses of Africa. So it's been an honor to actually serve a part of that in the African soil as a daughter of Ebukhosini. I've also done many other programs with Ebukhosini, but this is the big one. Give thanks, everyone.
But we miss you. We miss you, man.
Okay.
Well, thank you so much, Matsepo. And then we'll go now to Yonela. Yonela will be sharing with us about the spaces for Black men in the BML. So, Yonela, just stage is yours, Papa.
Give thanks, Mama T. Greetings, family. Greetings to everyone who's watching. So I'm going to, I'm part of the HCT for Shabaka, and one of the programs that Shabaka does is the Black Men's Lekgotla. So what the Black Men's Lekgotla is a safe space for African men to come together, together around certain topics that are vital to African manhood and masculinity. And we approach these topics with an approach of healing, with an approach of understanding, and with an approach of increasing one's consciousness of self and of Africa as a whole. It is a safe space where we literally are honest about what we are talking about and what we are going through. It's a safe space where you can even cry as a man and you won't be judged, where you can talk about even some of the most intricate things that are happening in your life, you know, and you will be understood, you will be received, you will be supported, and you will be carried. So Black Men's Lekgotla is vital in that there aren't any such spaces, or there aren't many such spaces in the world or in Africa. And we need spaces for men to be able to open up, you know, to shut down, or to not shut down, but to shatter walls that men have built around themselves, you know, so that they are able to love and be loved. They are able to carry their families in an African sense, and they are able to carry themselves in a way that they can be proud to be African men, and not to carry the stereotype, you know, that African men have been labeled as. And we know those stereotypes. I'm not going to say them now, but to shed, you know, all of that, you know, and to rise as African kings. We give thanks.
Thank you so much, Yonela Boya. You're also a board member of EBUKHOSINI Solutions. Thank you for shedding light on the work of Shabaka and the Black Men's Lekgotla. We're now going to see a video from a member who's also based in a different province of South Africa, in the KZN. His name is Siyabonga Lembede. And we asked him to say something about why has he come so many times to visit EBUKHOSINI, which is quite far from where he lives, and what has he done with what he has inspired to learn more about in his own community.
My name is Siyabonga Lembede. I am from Richards Bay, KwaZulu-Natal. I live 600 kilometers away from EBUKHOSINI Solutions, and we've been in communication with EBUKHOSINI since 2009 until now. I kept on going back at EBUKHOSINI Solutions because it's a space where I find myself connecting more with my spirituality, connecting more with my health issues, and learning more about political consciousness. With the lessons that I've taken from EBUKHOSINI Solutions, I've been able to implement them in my own community. We've been able to start a movement called Kumbaniya, which is a movement that we do events that are related with Black History Month, Africa Day, Marcus Garvey. So with those lessons from EBUKHOSINI Solutions, we are uplifting our community so that they know where they are coming from and where they are going. I would like you to follow EBUKHOSINI Solutions and be in contact with EBUKHOSINI Solutions. You won't regret this. If you want to be part of the solution and you want to escape the problem, follow EBUKHOSINI Solutions on a daily basis, and I promise you, you will become a better African. Uhuru.
Thank you for that sharing, Siyabonga. Now we are going to the next segment, which is going to be led by Thamsanqa Mhlanga, and he's going to give an overview about Shabaka and the work that they are doing. Thank you.
Greetings, EBUKHOSINI family. My name is Thamsanqa Mhlanga, and I've known EBUKHOSINI for 20 years, but I've been with Shabaka for the 14th year this year. And the improvement I've seen, you know, in the Shabaka interactions, I can say I've seen a lot of increased self-awareness. Many men who participate in Shabaka report a heightened awareness of their emotions, thoughts and behaviors. This leads to better understanding and management of their mental and emotional well-being. And some of the improvement is also from the communication skills, you know. Through the workshops and discussions, you know, at Shabaka, men learn effective communication techniques, you know, allowing them to express themselves more clearly and authentically, you know, in various aspects of their lives, including relationships, you know, and work. Another improvement would be, you know, their empathy and understanding. You know, Shabaka provides or fosters an environment, you know, where men can openly discuss, you know, sensitive topics such as masculinity, you know, racism and emotional expression. As a result, you know, participants, you know, often develop greater empathy and understanding towards others, leading to more inclusive and compassionate interactions in their communities. As to why I do this for free, you know, I can say I dedicate my time to Shabaka because it fulfills me on a deeper level. While there may be no financial gain, you know, the personal growth and fulfillment I witness in men who attend are valuable, very invaluable. So seeing individuals transform, you know, their lives through self-reflection, you know, empathy and improved communication brings me immense joy and purpose. It's not about what I gain materially, but rather, you know, the positive impact I can make in the lives of others in the community as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Tam Sanka for the wise words that he has shared about the Shabaka work. And also, I think he speaks for the whole family when he says, you know, it's really something that we are called to do. It's something that we wouldn't be able to not do. It's something that we really are passionate about. So this is great. We're going to go to a couple of other videos. The next video is from Khanyisa Mhlongo, who has worked with the African Winter School and also the African Play School. Let's hear what she says about that, the importance of that work.
My name is Khanyisa Mhlongo, and I joined EBUKHOSINI in 2023 in the Empowering African Children's Programs. Why do I think these programs are so important to teach children African issues? It's because exactly that's who they are. They are Africans, and it's better to start young so they grow up knowing about their identities, about their forefathers. And the younger you teach a child the skill, the better it is for them to grow up knowing and understanding and even teaching others. And that is why I joined these programs. The success of it, well, I've seen some of the children in the programs, and they remember so much of the songs and the stories that were shared. And that is the most important thing.
Thanks to the words of Khanyisa, reminding us of the importance of nurturing the African child. Now we're going to go to an elder, a distinguished and great elder in our community, Mama Thozi Tego. Some of you may have seen that we called the community for family constellation workshops, and I'm sure many people wonder what happens at a family constellation workshop. Here's Mama Thozi, she explains it for us.
Hello, my name is Thozi Tebogo. I facilitate family constellation processes. How do I know? EBUKHOSINI, I've known them for over 20 years, and I've had the joy of working with them in and out, and now, recently, we've had like solid few years together. And what happens in a family constellation process is that we look at an issue that one can bring, and within the space of a group, we map out the structure of your family. And when we do that, we bring back order and orders of love and harmony. And when that happens, healing happens in us, and healing happens around the people that belong to that group. The reason is that we all walk around with either some stuckness, some discomfort, or some traumas. And some of the trauma is intergenerational. In this mapping, the structure comes together in the way it's supposed to be. And when that happens, healing happens. And I trust that knowing all of this and about the EBUKHOSINI and all the things that are offered there, you will contact us. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Mama for the work that you do and for also sharing about it here. I think you now know that you need to be in the next family constellation workshop. We have mentioned that we do mentorship and coaching. We reach out to quite a lot of young people, both around the vicinity where the EBUKHOSINI offices are, but also in collaboration with other organizations. And we find it very important to do that as a way to prepare for the future. As we know, Africa has become a younger and younger continent in terms of age, and it's important that we are prepared to really nurture young Africa. Mama, we hear a lot about EBUKHOSINI's men's program, but where's the position of women in EBUKHOSINI? And I'm asking because there is a tendency within some like consciousness and Pan-African spaces that they become male dominated. What does EBUKHOSINI do to balance that?
We don't do anything. to balance that, we have a women's session that we are doing. But the whole point is not that you are doing it because men are healing Sabaka. You are doing it because we understand that it's important as a community, as people, we need to create spaces for us to reflect on ourselves. This reflection, it will help us to also to know how to relate. One of the issues that we tend to take it for granted is that the disruption of a family structure within the our African family structure. One of the things that it also has contributed, it is contributed in the challenges that we are facing of not even knowing how to relate. And when we don't know how to relate, first and foremost, as a family, and then also not be able to know how to relate as couples and as individuals, it becomes very difficult. Even when we are talking about all these issues of that we need to collaborate, we need to do some work together, we cannot be able to do that when we have not healed even certain issues and pains that we are holding. So the session for Kandaka space mainly focusing on women is to create an understanding of women also here, the issues that they might be challenged by in their own life, so that they can be able to be supportive to their own partners and for their own children, so that we can build a strong community. So that's why we need to have this space for women. And we also have, from there, that's why we have extended to have a workshop on Black love. And that workshop on Black love, it's just stemming from that. There's no way that you can love another person when you can love yourself. So we need to, as African people, to start knowing and understanding how to love ourselves so that we can be able to love each other and to be there for each other and support each other. That's why also the program or through Sabaka and Kandaka of Black Love is important for us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mama, for bringing that awareness in. We are now going towards one of the last segments of this presentation. We are presenting the work of EBUKHOSINI, and we are also launching our website. We are very proud. Ooh. Thank you, Tebogo, Matiana, for the incredible work that you have done. So you will have noticed that many refer to EBUKHOSINI. We have told you that it's a business, it's an organization, it's got professional services, it does many things. But many people also talk about EBUKHOSINI as a home. And I wanted to actually call on Tebogo Mashiana to explain a little bit about that. As somebody who came to EBUKHOSINI first and foremost as a home, what was that experience and how do young people relate to a home? Isn't a home full of restrictions? Isn't a home full of being reprimanded and disciplined? Can that even be nice?
Greetings, family. The name is Ntokozo Mashiana, Khabu, Mkandla, Phalanaka Phalaluyana, Nkome Kuvako Sokhabu, Ngimloyo. But yeah, to answer your question, Baba, so just to give a bit of context, some background story. When I came to EBUKHOSINI, you know, I was in a very dark place. Né? I come from very far away from Johannesburg. So I come from a small village in another province called Emachirini, KwaNdebele. That is where I come from. So I came to Joburg for academic purposes, of course. But then I was very lost in my life. So I needed a place where, you know, I could find people to talk to, that emotional support, that sort of cultural stability that is always seeking to ground me, mostly as a man, I feel I need to say that. So, yeah, I mean, I went to EBUKHOSINI. How I found out about EBUKHOSINI was through Unstuck. I was on Facebook. I saw an episode of Unstuck, and then Baba spoke about an event that they were going to have the following week. So then I came to EBUKHOSINI to the event. The energy was not lying. One thing I can tell you about EBUKHOSINI is that the energy does not lie. When you come to EBUKHOSINI, if EBUKHOSINI is not a place for you, you will know as soon as you step in the yard. So, but it was a very welcoming place for me in particular. I came in, you know, Lord Strider spoke to me and he said, "What took you so long, brother? We were waiting for you." And that was the kind of welcome that I received. So to further answer your question, Baba, home is typically a place where, you know, someone lives, they find shelter, their comfort, all of that. But EBUKHOSINI provides more than that. It's not just a physical space where you can just come. It also provides that cultural stability, as I mentioned, emotional support, and you are allowed to be yourself all the time. You will not be reprimanded all the time to say, "Hey, what are you doing? Get back here, do this, do that." No, you are allowed to be yourself. You can be in the kitchen and cook something for the family, you know. You can be in the library, read some books, you know, just gather people around, play the drums, start singing. It is a very fun place to be in. So, yeah, it's a lot. But just to speak to whether or not it is youth-friendly, it is very youth-friendly. EBUKHOSINI is a home. I cannot emphasize that enough. You know, as we live in a world where most young people are in the streets trying to find themselves, I would say that EBUKHOSINI is the best place for that. So do follow us on social media. There's a lot of content for you to, you know, just enjoy and convince you that EBUKHOSINI is the right place for you. Give thanks.
Thank you so much, Tebogo Mashiana, for what you have shared. I know it's a space of fun, but I know it's also a space where it can be awkward a little bit at times. It can be difficult. And I think I want to also say that we are not here to say that everything we do is super easy and always nice and beautiful. We also go through hardship. We also go through difficult times. But I think the lesson is that it's possible to find ways through them and do that together. The next segment, we're going to listen to a video recording from one of the first sons of EBUKHOSINI. His name is Tabomoyo Mukesi. He's also based in another province of the country. And here is his take on the lessons he gained from it.
Good day, everyone. My name is Tabo Mukesi. Just a brief background about EBUKHOSINI. I started working with EBUKHOSINI from 2004. And basically the work we were doing was mainly doing workshops, writing of proposals, and at the time I was still new. I couldn't write a proposal or report or everything like that. But with EBUKHOSINI I managed to gain some crucial skills that helped me on later on. I can now write a full proposal, I can implement proposal, I can write a report, basically a lot of things that I've learned at EBUKHOSINI. And also it also helped me with my self-esteem, and because I was very shy when I got to EBUKHOSINI, but they managed to, after long work and stressful days, I managed to break through that. And I've also learned about African history, which makes me in turn more confident, because I've got a better understanding of who I am, where I come from, and the journey that my people have walked to be here. So the journey that my people have walked so that I can be here. So there's a lot that I've learned from EBUKHOSINI. And now I'm also a father, so I'm transferring those lessons into my young one, and hopefully he can also be a warrior of EBUKHOSINI soon. Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you so much to Thabo Moyo Mokhesi for what you said there. We also want to hear from one of the daughters of the house. What is it like to be a young African woman in the house of EBUKHOSINI? Khanyisa Mhlongo, please share from your own experience.
So the experience is quite interesting. I think that because EBUKHOSINI is both a home and a working space, right? It can get a little bit overwhelming, but I must first say that it's my brothers, the sisters, the communication that we have, we're very close, you know, we hold each other, we are there for each other, name. So, but then when we come to the work part, because obviously there are some things that we come from our own household, like, for instance, I've seen some of the brothers would be asked what this is, you know, and that would be like, what this is, but I'm a man, what do you mean, you know, and then like sometimes they cook. I think for me, it was also very surprising when I got here, majority of the time, the guys that are cooking, it's also the guys that know how to keep the space clean, like they know the corners, oh, you need to do this and that, so that's also like a cultural shift, that's one of the practical things, like, and the brothers are very understanding, they also know how to communicate, like they can actually say, you know, I really don't like that, and you're like, how? Okay, I hear you, I'm gonna change this fine, because we normally don't hear that, you know, you just see people
snap
or be aggressive, and you don't understand what's happening. And then I think that for us, some of us, like, we like working myself. So now, because I was like, I asked you to send a document, and you're like, yeah, no, I'm going to send the document. And then because we don't come from home where, in most cases, it functions like that, like, we don't really have responsibility of maybe administration, it's very challenging to come into a space that requires you to be like that. Like Ubuntu was saying that writing a proposal, I mean, what is a proposal, you know? And then that proposal also means a lot, you know, it impacts everyone. Like you get responsibility, like you get responsibility, and you need to show up, and you need to make sure that you deliver at a very great standard, because the standard is a very high one. And then our emotions sometimes, like, because we come for counseling, and then you also need to learn how to deal with your emotions, which is something that you don't get from home. Like, if your mom asks you to wash the dishes, it's not really about how was your day, like, you feel washing dishes, you know. But sometimes, yeah, you can be like, hey, guys, I don't feel like washing dishes, I'm not okay. Then they'll give you the space, yeah? And then after that, if it's over space, that space is too much. Like, maybe 2 days, especially in space, it's like, no, you need to pull it together instead of your work, you know? And then you would watch. So there's also a lot of confrontation. Like, you will be confronted, like, if your behavior is not right, and not what you're doing, like, weird extreme stuff, but, like, maybe you a little bit mean when you talk, or you don't respond well, you don't account, like, mother, what happened here, you can't really say it's me, you know? And I think that helps us as we grow, because then we become different, then we can count, then we can see, then we can relate better, you know? It's like a bubble of ours, like, I don't know how the world functions now, because we have that secure space, you know, like I was telling Abu Baba that here it's a space where if you just cross the road and you're like, hey, I crossed the road, you know, it seems you can come to that, it's like, what? You did that? And you're like, I actually did it. So I think, yeah.
Okay. Let me just, no, thank you, Khanyisa, but let me just tell you that the sons and daughters of EBUKHOSINI do much more than crossing the road. That's not even something. But the example is that you get support and that you are in a space, even on those days that are not so nice, you are still being held. You still know that you have a place that is your comfort and your safety. And I must say, as somebody who has been trained in my fatherhood by many of the young people on this platform, it's also a very nurturing place in your development as a parent. I think as we don't live in a time where being an elder means that you necessarily know how to guide and be there for young people. So we also need to learn to be good parents and elders. People who are watching, we have now gone through the programs of EBUKHOSINI. We are now coming to the segment where we just want to close, and we are going to close by asking each member here in the EBUKHOSINI studio to say, who do you specifically welcome to EBUKHOSINI, and why should they come?
I will welcome all the women, all Black women that are seeking to understand what it means to be them, that are tired to fall into the stereotypes of what it means to be a woman generally and what it means to be an African woman. I call them to say, this is time for us to take a seat, take a center stage, and we bring an element of this missing piece of what it needs to be us. And we do that by also creating new opportunities for ourselves, by bringing in all those knowledge that are forgotten, and we're making them modern and working and relevant and now. Thank you.
Fire. I want to welcome all boys and men, all Black boys and men who think that they can do better, think that life can be lived a bit differently, understand that they may miss something in their lives and not always sure how to articulate that. At EBUKHOSINI, you will definitely meet other brothers who walk a similar path, who are asking questions, who are trying to also understand what kind of man does Africa need today? Not just what kind of men were we before, or what does a man need to do. We need to ask first, what does Africa need and how do we serve Africa? So if that's something that you're interested in, I'm inviting you to come through, be part of our program, engage with us online. And do you have any questions? Don't hesitate to send us your question. Don't hesitate to communicate with us. We are not afraid of questions. We will also tell you when we don't know, because we don't know everything. But the things that we do know, we are very willing to share, and we invite you to come and learn with us, develop with us, empowering ourselves with us. Khanyisa, who would you like to invite?
I would like to invite all youth, especially African youth, if you are looking for a space where you want to belong, a place where you want to be heard, a place where you want to heal, a place where you want to talk and express yourself, a place where you just like art, because a lot of our youth members are poets, musicians, dancers, and very much academic. I'm calling you if you want to belong in a community that loves you and serves you and also helps you develop as an individual.
Thank you so much, Khanyisa. If by now you have no interest in anything that we say, I'm not sure what we can do for you. But still, even if you still question, at least contact us and find out. There might be something we haven't touched on that actually you are interested in. At this point, we want to close it down. And there is an expression that we often use to really vibrate and put the fire in us as African people, which is the Kiswahili expression, harambe, which means pulling together. And that's one thing we learn time and time again at EBUKHOSINI, that without unity, without lifting and holding space for and with each other, we become lonely, we become dysfunctional, and we don't know how to move forward. And forward, we must move. So I'm going to count to three, and I want everybody in the recording here to shout harambe, but I even want you, wherever you are sitting, even if you are on the bus, even if you are in your car, wherever you are, you should shout this with us, and you will see the change. 1, 2, 3.
Harambe!
Harambe!
Thank you so much for having me to us. Please engage with us. We're looking forward.